Ja, hallo. So, I'm Michael Schröder. I started at SUSE at about 2000. First time I came in contact with open source was with GNU's Green, where I'm one of the three authors. And so when I joined SUSE, I came to the Audible team, which is the team that formerly did all the packaging and product creation. And of course, we always used RPM. It was then pretty clear that I had to, and the guy that was the RPM maintainer before didn't want to do it anymore. It was pretty clear that I had to take over RPM from him, and so I came to be the RPM maintainer. Yeah. Being in the Audible team, at some time created the Delta RPM suite you already now use, also use in Fedora. That's, if you run Yum Presto, you get that nice download. It's downloading only the Delta RPM and applies it then afterwards, and so it doesn't needs only to download 10% or so of the RPMs it used to download before. So then at some point in time, we at OpenSUSE, when OpenSUSE came into existence, basically there was a big consensus that we wanted to make our build process open and get everybody involved so that every developer outside could be contributing to SUSE. And so we decided to write the open build service, which Adrian is going to talk about in 2 hours or so. So I'm also one of the main architects of the build server, of basically of the core component, the scheduling, and how the workers work, and so on. I wrote out that. And as I'm the Perl maintainer, the build service is that part of the build service also written in Perl, which for your Python guys is maybe a bit of a downside. But hey. Okay. And the last thing I did is I wrote that libsolve library that is now used in Hawkey and so is used in DNF, and that's why it may be used in Yum later on when DNF is rebranded into Yum again. So the roadmap of this talk is going to be, first the reason I'm doing this talk is because I wanted to show you what libsolve has for features that are currently not used, not there in Fedora. So when DNF is going to be the main package manager with Hawkey and libsolve using it, used by DNF, you get basically almost all of those extra features for free, and you can decide which of the features you want to pick and use in Fedora as well or Red Hat as well. So this talk is about showing you what the features of libsolve are, more or less. So let's start with those optional dependencies or weak dependencies, as they're sometimes called. They were added to SUSE to that distribution in 2006 when we switched over to libsup. Sup itself then is an acronym of Zenworks YAST Package Manager. YAST is yet another setup tool, so it's an acronym of acronym. And libsup is Zenworks, is a part that came from the Xemium guys. So the Xemium guys had their RUC manager, and which is used for cluster management basically, and Zenworks team. And then we had the YAST guys, that was the SUSE software management stack, and so upper management decided we can't do a shootout between the two, so they have to merge somehow, and that's how libsup came into existence. And libsup was basically a bastard child between the old YAST and the Zenworks team, which had some real disadvantages, which, I mean, you probably heard that the software stack in the 10.1 and /10 series was really, really not that what you would expect from a software stack. So people were complaining quite a bit. Yeah, but anyways, with that, Zenworks rewrite merging, YAST and libsup learned to do that weak dependencies. And weak dependencies are optional dependencies. I'm saying optional dependencies in the talk here because these dependencies come in a normal and a reverse flavor, and also in a strong and a weak flavor. The concept is taken from Debian, as you probably know. Debian has recommends, suggest, and enhances. And for some reason, they don't lack the fourth one. I don't know why. And normally, recommends is where the packager says, it's really a good idea to install that package if you install the other package. So this is really a good thing to have. And suggest is, hey, I just move on the slide. Yeah, it's better. This recommends is really you should install that. It doesn't break your system if you don't install it, but it's a good thing to have. And suggests is it's many users also enjoy installing that package. Just I want to tell you that it's a good idea, but I'm fine if you don't want to install it. So this is something. Yes, and that's also what we do in libsolve then. Recommends is something that the solver automatically chooses to install for you. So from a user perspective, it's a package that's auto-selected by the solver and the user can unselect it or to remove it after it's installed if it doesn't like it anymore, so something. And suggests as libsub presents you in the user graphical user interface. There's a page where you can see all the suggested packages, and you can check the description and maybe select the ones you like, or simply ignore them. The command line client super completely ignores suggest, I think. Whereas the reverse dependencies also come in those strong and weak flavors with the same semantics. That's the weak thing is ignored by the solver. Here's an example. GIMP plugins Python, that's normally where the supplements are used with plugins or something like that. So the package author of the plugin says, this is a plugin for GIMP. Install me if you install GIMP. So he adds, or she adds a supplements colon GIMP. And it's in the package metadata, and so the solver knows if GIMP is selected for whatever reason, it should also install GIMP plugins Python. And if you can get away of doing it with recommends if you have complete control over repository metadata, because you can, instead of putting that supplements in the Python plugin package, the GIMP package could also include a recommends of the plugin. But then, of course, you have to know which plugins exist in the world, which doesn't work. It works if you have a single repository, but it fails to work if you have third-party vendors which provide plugins, or if you have some build service with personal package archive or something. I don't know, it's called in Fedora Ubuntu, it's personal package archive. Where people can upload their plugins to, you have those repositories where you can upload packages. So when some guy uploads a plugin there, you can't expect the GIMP author to add the recommends there, right? So this is where the reverse dependencies are really a good thing to have for third-party folks.
Is there also a reverse
requires? We had it in the first concept, but it's... When we told you guys that there's also, it was called essential for, but when we told you guys, I think Steve really said, this is awful. I add a repository and suddenly if you do a RPM verify, my installation is broken just by adding the repository. Yes, you're right, as always. And scratch that. So it's just those dependencies.
Okay.
Yeah. In many cases, you need an and. Like with a plugin, this Python plugin, as I spoke before, you want to install that only if you have Python installed and not just when you have GIMP installed, right? Because it's a Python plugin. So what you want to say is, install me if both GIMP and Python is installed. So unfortunately, RPM doesn't have that and syntax. So we did a really awful hack and added that package end pseudo namespace. It looks like that. So supplements package end gimp colon Python. It must be a it mustn't be a comma because RPM splits dependencies with when it sees a comma. So we have a colon as package separator. But yeah, good thing. For the, as it's a supplements and RPM doesn't understand supplements at all and doesn't need to understand this, we can put any syntax there we like. So it's for RPM it's ignored and we can do really strange stuff because the layer above RPM, which the libsolve is interprets it and not RPM itself. So you need to patch RPM. Maybe in the far, far future, we talked about that, RPM may also get OR dependencies and dependencies, and then you can do that in a correct, more correct way. Maybe. Yeah, another part where supplements are useful are packet splits. I learned today that Fedora does, Red Hat does it a bit different with obsoletes, but here's what SUSE does. So if packet split happens, when you split a sub-package from a main package, there you have that, by the way, sorry about that, the errors ending in the text, that's the PDF conversion of LibreOffice. Yeah, should have updated to a newer version, I guess. Well, anyways. So you maybe in that example, you split a doc package. Oh, the example is about the devil package. You split it. The old A2PS didn't have a devil package for whatever reason, and now you want to split the devil package from A2PS. So what happens is that A2PS obsolete, automatical obsolete, the old version. But if you want to do an update and you have the old package installed, then after the update, you want to have the new version of A2PS installed, plus the APS devil package, because you want to keep the status quo, right? You had that the devil package was included in A2PS before. You want to have the same status quo as before, so you want to have A2PS.a installed afterwards as well. So this is why at the far part, in the past, in 1999, those split provides were added. So now, this is, of course, also a hack because we didn't have supplements and other things that tags in RPM at that time, so we had to use one of the existing dependencies. So we put it into provides. Provides is also ignored by RPM if it doesn't hurt. If you put it in requires, the package can't really be installed anymore, but provides, in extra provides, doesn't hurt RPM. It blows up the database a bit. It provides index maybe, but okay. So it landed in provides, but hey, so what? And the syntax was provides colon the old package name colon and a file from the old package. So when the solver sees a package with that name and that file is installed, it knows that it must install the devil package. The provides has to be in the devil package, of course. So what libsolve now does is it sees the old provides, rewrites it into supplements, special supplements, and so the package gets automatically selected. As I learned today, in Red Hat you do that with an obsoletes in the devil package, but the disadvantage is that you can't deselect the devil package then because you will get an error from YUM. I mean, I don't know if you even can do the update and deselect packages in one step. Is that possible? So anyway, that's so this is aimed also at Elish a bit with Hockey, that when he sees package split code in libsolve, that's what it's about. It's about doing that automatic installations. Now, this is a nice thing. We also use supplements for language packages. So, example here again, we have this GTKI term here, package that provides, it basically says, install me if GTK2 is installed and the user selected a Japanese or a Korean or a Chinese language. So you don't have to, I think you do all the language selection in your comms package, packages, right? In the comms data. But it's the comms data contains this for this language, which has this disadvantage of the third parties. I talked before, if the third party has a language and package in its repository, you would have to patch. Okay, so that works, yeah, but you still you have to somehow create that comms file. And it's that competition think it's nicer to let the packager decide or declare that this is a language package. It's, I think it's a nicer way. And I think this is the last usages of supplements I want to tell you. We use it also for hardware-dependent packages. So for this Broadcom package, you see here, it basically says, install me if your hardware, if some file in the sys directory, a file called mod alias, contains something that matches this glob string. So basically, install me if you have the hardware, right? And you can also specify a package that needs to be installed so that you can even have this install me if this package is installed and you have the hardware, which is normally then in that case, it's a kernel module and it's a specific kernel flavor the package is used for. Sorry? It goes into the modulars. You could, I'm not even sure, I think libsolve wouldn't pass that with package, the parser isn't that good enough, but it would just be an entry before the PCI here. No. So it more consistent, but yeah, but it's not history. This is included in slash 10, and I had to be compatible, so I, you know how it goes. Hot plug? I don't think so. You could integrate it for SUSE. The super has an option to install the recommended packages. So the hot plug daemon could then run super and to see which packages get installed. And you could make that work, yes. But currently, no integration. And there also was some time ago there was a HAL supplements, but nobody used. We used the hardware extraction layer, but use turned out to not be useful. And then the HAL library was removed, so the code was also removed. And also we have, so I was lying, we also have the file system supplements, which is not very interesting. You can say this package supports that file system, and when that file system is used on the system, then you the solver auto selects that package. Okay, now this basically was to show you what to do with those optional dependencies and how useful they are for third-party packagers, for declaring languages, packages, for doing other stuff. And now I want to talk to you a bit about the difference of the solver library between how the libsolve works and how YUM solving works. So first of all, a bit of a history. it was quite fun to dig that up because before last week, I didn't know that at all. And so I asked around and who did that and why did that? Why was it even included? So the first solver of the YAS2 package management came actually from Caldera. So maybe you remember United Linux before Caldera went Scottish. They used to participate in Linux, in United Linux So the deal was that this was basically, the solver was Caldera's gift to United Linux. So the solver was written by three guys from Erlangen in Germany, actually, and then some more a student at SUSE integrated it into the YAST2 system. YAST itself, the old text-based installer, didn't have a solver at all. That automatically, a very, very basic solver where the user was asked if there was multiple packages providing something, and there was some alternative. The user basically was asked which alternative to use. So it was, it was okay at that time because the dependencies were much, much less than today. So it worked at that time, but. So anyways, back to the talk. So the Caldera Phi solver package handling improved, the guys told me, was the solver used in YAST2. And then for /9 and /8 and /10 had that god awful CMD merge, the YAST2 with the Xenworks management, and the solver was actually taken from Xenworks. So the YAST2 solver for /10 is from Xemion. Xemion people wrote that. And the Xemion solver was the solver where all that optional dependency handling was integrated to. Yeah, and post 11.2 was the time from libsolve at that time it was called libsat solver, but as some people complained that libsat solver is maybe a bit too generic if it's about package dependencies, and sat solving is a very common concept, of course, and with lots of different solvers. I decided to rename it from libsat solver to libsolve, so that's why it's called libsolve today, but the code base is more or less the same. And it's based on the Boolean satisfiability problem, which is something we have rules with app and with ands and ors and the package and can be installed or must not be installed. So I have got really a big formula that the solver tries to make true. It's incomplete, so it may take a while to solve, but in most cases, so from the forks, from the solve forks, SAT server forks, package handling is a super easy problem. It's just a small set of rules, so maybe 100,000 or so. That's from the SAT server people's perspective, that's nothing. So they have this real big shootouts where they every year one solver wins, and it's different class. You can't compare it. So normally for package management, the SAT server is super fast. Let me just check my time. I've started at 20. And how long? I'm good, right? Okay. Yeah. So, of course, it's an NP-complete problem, and the algorithm guarantees that if there's a solution for a problem, then the SAT server will find it. So, if for very pathological cases, it may really take some time as well, but then it's still faster than all other dependency solvers I know of. I mean, that's a drawback. If it always finds a solution, then it gives you solutions that really, where you say afterwards, hey, what is that? you want to do what to my system? How can you even come up with that solution? But from dependency standpoint, it's okay. If everything is correct afterwards. Yeah, it's especially for B-Arch. So the solution is to switch the packages completely to 32-bit or something, so because the library doesn't exist at 64-bit. So the solution is make my system 32-bit. Is up to what? Sorry, optimal? No. That mainly is because it's really hard to tell what an optimal solution looks like. So that's a bit. That's normally not. Let's let. That's one. You can define many such things: least numbers to download, the sizes to download must be minimal, or most package afterwards up to date, or so. You can define very, very, very many metrics. But from my point of view, I want to keep things simple and intuitive to the user. So what this LibSolve does is pretty much a greedy algorithm with backtracking, more or less. And the
also, you get, if you want, you can see all the alternatives. That's more than one.
LibSolve can do that. LibSip doesn't use it. Yes. But you could. So you probably saw that when YAM runs into an error, it will simply abort. And this is an easy example because then you look at the error message and say, oh, Hilofox conflicts with ZenFox. And so, okay, I'll just have to deinstall ZenFox. But those error messages can be really, really long. And if there are multiple problems, you don't even know what, if there are multiple solutions, you don't know which error messages belong to which solution. So it's, especially if you have multiple arguments on the comment line. So which error came from which argument? Or is it an interaction between the two arguments? Or? So what LibSolve does and LibZip always did, it was added in 2002, was it presents you with problems and solutions. So basically, it asks you what to do and says, hey, your request, I couldn't fulfill it, but I can do something like that if I are allowed to do something. And then it asks if it's okay to downgrade a package, because LibSolve doesn't downgrade packages. It first asks the user if it has to downgrade packages, or if it is about deinstalling a package. In this case, it's solution one, deinstalling, and solution two is in that case just don't install Hilofox, which is okay if you have multiple arguments and doesn't make sense at all if you have just one argument. So if you ask Zipper to install Hilofox, why would I choose a solution to not install Hilofox? So. And the solution can consist of multiple actions. This is what LibSolve does, which is nice. So if it's about multiple packages conflicting, then the solution will be deinstall that package, maybe downgrade that package, maybe, and so on. So you can have a very good overview of what will happen, what happens if I choose that solution, and what will my system look like afterwards. So this is quite nice. And this is basically gets more and more important if you have multiple repositories from different people that don't work together. You have one repository where people, you build everything with everything, then you normally don't have any problems with dependencies because the packages are built against each other and work with each other. But if you have some group somewhere which builds a new KDE stack and you have the KDE stack from then and the X server from this X server guys, which is built in another repository, you can get really, really nasty dependency problems where the solution list is maybe 5 or 6 solutions. So it's then downgrade the X server to the one from the Fedora core repository, and then I can install that KDE. So it gets really important if you have lots of repositories by different people. Okay, another super interesting thing, nice thing to have is that LibSolve does and LibZip does, is it can write test cases. This is something for Eilish. So Zip has the option -- debug solver, where it writes a test case, and the test case contains everything to reproduce the solver run. So if we at SUSE get a bug report, hey, your solver did something totally stupid, there's a standard answer: please attach a solver test case. And then the user attaches the solver test case. We can run the solver and maybe in a debug lab and turn on debugging and see exactly why the solver worked like it did. And then it turned out that it's a bug in some package with some dependencies. So in 99% 0.9% the solver is cracked and it's just a bug in the package. This is a really good thing to add to DNF. This is something I just wanna tell you. It's nothing I really would really recommend to Red Hat or Fedora. It's called vendor locking. Basically, it makes sure that installed packages don't get switched to another vendor. So it was added in 2003 because users installed their own version of packages and complained that they get replaced with the SUSE package again. So, and it's also multiple it's useful for the multiple repository case where you just have one package from that repository and you don't somehow want it to lock it to that repository. So we do that with that vendor locking, but it has a big drawback: users don't understand it. We always get bug reports, didn't upgrade that package, and it turns out it's because of it's a different vendor and the new version is from a different vendor and that's where it wasn't updated. So this is something that is in some cases really nice to have, but users tend to not understand it. So maybe it could be an optional thing for Red Hat or Fedora, I don't know. Just wanted to mention it. Okay, that brings me to the end of my talk. So just to recapitulate, libsolve has some kind of neat things that are not already present in Red Hat or Fedora, and as you probably gonna use libsolve in the near future or 2 years, Alice said 2 years, then it's the official solver. Or so.
I don't know.
Hopefully. So you might to kind of cherry pick the features you like and disregard the stuff you don't like. Okay. Any questions? Alice is hopefully writing a big. So there is on the SUSE wiki, there's a lot of documentation about the libsip forks. When they did this /9 thing, they really did quite a good documentation of that feature. So it should be somewhere. It was somewhere. We had that reorganization of the wiki a year ago, and nobody finds anything anymore. But okay. Okay, I'll just check. We have a notebook if it's somewhere. I know that it was documented. This essential for was documented somewhere. As the suggestion was documented, but it must be on the RPM mailing list, I think, somewhere, because the suggestion was sent to the mailing list, as far as I remember. Somewhere in RPM maint. You can do that. You have libsolve provides a solution callback where you can automate which. So it does automatically rerunning with all alternatives for you and calls you with every solution it finds, and you return a metric value, and then it presents, it maximizes that value. So the code is kind of there. It's never been tested. It's just, so yes, maybe DNF will have that sometime. But as I said, I'm not a big fan of those metrics. They tend out because the new version has three sub-packages split from them and it requires those sub-packages. So is it a bad thing so that it's three packages now? So the number of packages for the update is not really a good metric. Maybe it's just that it's more fine granularly split. It's possible from Lipsolf, yes. Anything else? There's a bit of code cleanup. Some things don't really work well, but from a feature standpoint, it's pretty feature complete. So I'm quite confident that the AP won't change that much anymore. Maybe not at all. And I just remove some bugs that I don't know there, but that don't matter for the normal SAT solving. It's a bit, there are some quirks in the way the metadata handling works. So you already ran into something once, but nothing that it's very really relevant for package solving in YAM and or DNF. Okay. Oh. So. Actually, the tags are already there because Jeff Johnson added them, I think, for Mandriva, I think, sometime in the past. Some other distribution that also did that optional dependency. So there are tags for enhances and suggests. And the only thing I added at that time is a flag this way where you can tell that this is a strong dependency. So it's not enhances, but supplements or recommends and not suggests. So, but this bit is, since a long time, been in RPM upstream. It's the sense strong bit. Pan, who knows that? So it's just a tag like the normal requires. And of course, we have patches for create repo to put it in the metadata. OK, awesome. Thank you.